Ali Muhammad Salim Ali. He is here also today with us. And then we will open the floor for question and answer if you have any. And then we try to make this event within 1 hour. Unless we have long questions and discussions, we appreciate any kind of like comments or question that would you have. So thank you. I would hand over now to His Excellency Permanent Representative of Sudan to do the opening speech.
Your Excellency Ali Muhammad Salim, State Minister of Defense, Mine Action National Program Directors, United Nations Advisors and International Organizations, His Excellency Ambassador of Italy in Sudan, ENMAS Program Manager in Sudan, ladies and gentlemen, peace be upon you. It is my pleasure to participate in this side event on the intercultural communication and the mine action, the case of the Sudan. First, I would like to express my appreciation to His Excellency Ambassador of Italy and His Excellency Ambassador of Japan in Sudan and the United Nations Mine Action Service Program Director in Sudan for the major role that they have done to help the Sudan to fulfill its commitment towards Ottawa Convention. Ladies and gentlemen, the importance of mine action program in Sudan comes within the state's plan of security and peace in the country, which concerning the security and safety of citizens as a top priority. The popular, official, and international concreted effort with our commitment to harness all available resources and provide the required support for mine action program activities. Sudan is party to the Convention of Banning the Use of Anti-Personnel Mines and Their Destruction, also known as Ottawa Treaty, since the 1st of April 2004. Sudan is committed with all articles and provisions of the Ottawa Convention and contributing financially towards the full implementation of the Convention. Thus, Sudan allocated an amount of $2 million last year and approved the same amount for this year, 2017, while launching the final phase of the clearance of the Red Sea states last week, with the fund allocated for the year 2017 in the presence of His Excellency the State Minister of Defense and the United Nations Mine Action Service Program Director in Sudan, to declare the eastern states of Sudan by the end of this year entirely free of registered area or areas contaminated by mines and unexploded ordnance. Ladies and gentlemen, Sudan government and people appreciate the effort made by the United Nations Mine Action Service Office in Sudan and the support provided to us by friendly countries and partners, and the support from the civil society organization in mine actions. We assure you that we will go forward in completing the clearance of all registered hardest areas contaminated by mines and explosive remnants of war. We will not rest until we clear every inch of our country and make it free of mines and remnants of war to complete the development projects and service to cover all regions of Sudan. Hence, the importance of this program is achieving our goals and our aspirations towards a better future for our country. Finally, we assure you that we will make every effort available to achieve the security and welfare of our people, fulfill Ottawa Convention obligation, stressing and progress in this program that we achieved together present quite achievement, but a lot of work ahead of us to accomplish what is left, and through the ongoing cooperation, we can reach the Sudan free of mines and explosive remnants of war. Thanks and appreciations to the decent attendance, and through you, our thanks extend to the United Nations Organization, civil society organizations, and special thanks to the countries supporting the program, Italy, Japan, and China, and thanks also to the United Nations Mine Action Office in the Sudan and to all partners. Peace be upon you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, His Excellency. So now at this stage, I will talk a little bit or update you what exactly is in Sudan in regards to the intervention of UNMAS, working with the National Mine Action Center, and the intervention and support from the international community and the funding. So you can click next, please. So if you look at the map, currently that's how the situation is in regards to the contamination. The red is indication of the highest contamination, where it go, the green is completely with no contamination, while the gray indicates only the UXO contamination. So only four states are currently remain to be with known landmines and ERW contamination in Sudan, while Darfur states are recorded to be with UXO contamination at this stage. Among all of that, South Kurdufan is the state with the highest level of mines and ERW contamination. Gadarif state, which is on the right, the third from the top, is the state which was announced free of landmines and ERW in May 2016. There was historical support from international community. A lot was done. But the important thing to highlight is the last bit of the minefields that were remaining was cleared with the funding from the government of Sudan, which was earlier announced by His Excellency. So the commitment from Sudan and the international funding altogether is making a good progress. And the two upper states on the left is in Sudan, east of Sudan. The program is quite on track in regards to completing them by end or just before end of 2017, which is this year, and the eastern states will be announced free of known contamination, and there is plan of a major country-level celebration for that. South Kurdufan and Blue Nile, the southern region, had been a challenge due to ongoing conflict since 2011, July. But with the removal of sanctions, there has been quite good talks and possibilities, and also the ceasefire for the 6 months, that there is a good chance of doing a good operation in that area. So we hope for the best in coming future. Donors are also showing interest in funding that activity, and we will enable a lot of humanitarian aid delivery to the people in need, especially those who need emergency food support and vaccination, medical care. Next, please. So basically in Sudan, what UNMAS does is, in brief, enhancing the capacity of the National Mine Action Center and relevant NGOs, enhancing the technical capacity, quality management, and information management. While resource mobilization is another major role that we play to provide the elements in the field, like clearance team who can do clearance to be coordinated and managed by the National Mine Action Center. We have at the last, with us, the director of National Mine Action Center, Amir Abdussadiq, who has been playing a very great role with his team. And then also to be a platform for coordination between the government of Sudan, UN, and donor. So I just would like to draw your attention to this triangle, and you see cuts in there. That's the triangle concept that we looked into. When we as UNMAS returned back to Sudan, there was a history most of you know. I don't want to repeat that. I think we have been doing that in the past. So in July, in April 2015, UNMAS returned back to Sudan. There was a cut on mine action, particularly between the UN and the government, between the UN and the donors, and between the donors and government on working together with particular to mine action and doing clearance. So what we did is we tried to connect these disconnects. Next, please. And next. So the communications started. We first linked UN with the government, agreed how we are going to proceed, then UN with the donors, how do we going to proceed, and then all together. And we all together in one room, and we also invited media to have an eye on this. Click next, please. Next, please. So media had been covering each and every kind of events, and it was all over the newspapers or TV now and then. What we tell the media, this is a story that is building up, so please continue to follow us, and this is what they did. This is just an example of country coordination, where on the disk that you see, this was an event we organized in October 2016 at the residency of His Excellency Ambassador of Italy, who is with us today. 70 people attended that. Among them were 20 ambassadors, including the main donors. RCHC is Martha, exactly next to His Excellency, and we have Ambassador of Japan and the representatives from the government of Sudan, high level. So next, please. And we also organized a field visit for this triangle. At the first, you see His Excellency, State Minister of Defense, who is with us today. And in the back is Martha. She is the UNRCHC in Sudan. And then me as UN, it's like we are supporting the government and the donors are behind us. So all the four ambassadors, we had Japan, Italy, US, and also Sweden. So this was like we went to the field to see the operation and see what it means. It's all in one. And this was a small flight that we took, the UN flight, to go to the field. I will stop at this, and I will hand over to His Excellency Ambassador of Italy, Mr. Fabrizio Labasso. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, or good evening, I think. Now, well, my role, even as a chair of the Mine Action Support Group, is the one also to let emerge some aspects that maybe were hidden before and try to help, I would say, coordinating better and better our job on the spot in Khartoum. And that's why we are talking here about culture and intercultural aspects. First of all, maybe it can be an evidence, but I think it is nice to underline that we're talking about a cultural matter, because we are different interlocutors at stake. We have a culture, that is the culture of UNMAS. There is a sum of the culture of people working in, of the headquarters, of the quarter, of the program in Sudan, and so the people working there. So it's a mix and complex entity, but it's a culture, because culture is I would say, a way of life, a way of a group of beliefs, but also habits and verbal, non-verbal communication, behaviors and activities. Next, please. But also, we're talking about something intercultural because it's not only Ummas. We have here at stake Sudan has country that hosts us and is also the one that take the benefit. And we have to respect in some way some aspects that for Sudan are fundamental, crucial, much more sometimes than we think. And the more the diversity in cultural terms, the more the complex issue and the more the efforts we have to do in order to combine and to put all together in order to have the same objective. We're talking also about a third interlocutors, donors. Not all donors, we'll see in a while, are the same. Not all donors react in the same way towards cooperation, development cooperation. You have had their idea. Every day I just confront myself with my colleagues in Sudan, and I have to say that the Netherlands, Sweden, Britain, United States, cooperation is just a term. But then when we go into the deep part and into the implementation of activities, we have different ways of delivering our help to the country. So it's an intercultural matter because all these three, just like the triangle that we saw before, they interact continually and sometimes in a very, very complex way. And I have to say, I feel also comfortable in being chair for the 2016-2017 of the MASG, because in some way our role is not only helping, but in some ways facilitating this kind of passage between cultural, multicultural, pluricultural to intercultural. Intercultural, you can see it as a triangle where you have the base. You have A, culture B, in the search of a synthesis point that is culture C, that is something that in some way puts together and gets to better results. Also because, next, please, intercultural has a very good researcher in the past. His exchanging a mutual, and I wanted to underline mutual, because it's not a win-lose situation. It is not, we're not talking about the development cooperation of the past in which I had the solution, I had the recipe, and I come and I impose it to you, and that's it. It's on the contrary. You go there, you observe, we'll see in a minute, and so it's a mutual, it's a win-win situation in which you have to find, you know, the best way to delivery this kind of help of a dynamic and evolutional relationship. That means that it's in a continual move. And this is the most important part. It's not something that you can, you know, just rely on an activity one day and then waiting the day after or probably the months after with some events or with some results or some research. It's a hard work, I have to say, that the more intercultural, the more effective, the more synthetic, the more inclusive, the more syncretic, the more it would be effective for the three interlocutors of the relationship. The next. So, very, very, very fast. I tried also with Javed to underline the main goals of, you know, just a program like the one UNMAS Sudan is implementing in the country. First of all, optimizing UNMAS activities in the Sudan. This is in terms of time, funding, money, in terms of cooperation, implementing effective activities. So it's something that you can see. I hope for a lot of donors and colleagues of mine to have the same experience that I had in order to go on the spot, on the field, and to see these people, these marvelous people, working there and very, very slowly detecting all the, you know, just the equipment sometimes, you know, just under the sand, risking lives. And it's something that is some experts say it is a storytelling, and storytelling is motivation, and motivation gives the chance to do better your job. It's not only enterprises that use storytelling. This is, we should start also in public administration or international public administration like the United Nations are. Creating mutual trust, and this is, I can underline with my Sudanese friend here, trust is something fundamental, because trust is a value. A value is the core of a sort of onion that you can see in the intercultural speaking, where you have the superficial part outside, but the deepest you go, you find the real core of this onion. There are the values, the strong values of a country. The values are the issues that make you react, sometimes also violently, when somebody put it in a different perspective from yours. But we will see in a while. Implementing responsive communication. Communication is not only talking. Responsive communication is listening more. In the counseling sciences, you have listening 90% of 1 hour of therapy with somebody. Also, in our job, in diplomacy, in development and cooperation, responsive communication, it's a win-win situation in which there is not somebody that talk and the other one that listen and say, yes, okay, you are right. It's probably on the contrary, yes. The more you listen, the more you understand from a country. Maximizing benefits for Sudan people, obviously, this is the most fantastic, common ground. This is the real win-win situation, a part of the institutional problem, a part of the differences in geopolitical. We are talking about people. We are talking about children, running again on a field, and mothers, just with their water in their vases, just going from a village to another, and spices, commerce and trade, going from Eritrea to Sudan and back. And this is maximizing benefits for Sudan people, and also the fundraising that we're trying to do our best with this continual coordination that we have. Going to the core, which are the intercultural issues, the most important one to focus on? And I tried to adapt a model of intercultural communicative competence of two Italian professors of the University of Venice, that is Paolo Balboni and Fabio Caon, that they invented this model in which you can take the most important part. Which are the most important aspects that a mission like UNMAS Sudan should focus on? First of all, values, as I told you before. Values is not a single list of issues. Religion, gender, family, relationship with the eldest people, time, space, money. And, the list is really, I can continue, even because different areas of the world, different values. And some values that sometimes are very, very important in a country are not important in another country. That's why we have to have this kind of responsive communication, because if I understand that a value is very, very important to be respected in a country, it's obvious that I will pay a lot of attention, notwithstanding the fact that in my country. I make an example. There are some countries, especially, for example, in the eastern part of the world, where the society is collectivist. The group is more important than the individual. And there are other countries, the Western countries, that it's more individuals. The individual is more important than the group. And this is an important, a very important step to start with, because it's different way of structuring, just the norms, the laws, the way you approach people, because where the group is important, more important of an individual part, you cannot force individual to do something that is out of the group, because it would be a shame. And on the way back, on the way around. Verbal and nonverbal communication, that makes sometimes, just smile people, because what is it, verbal, nonverbal? I'm talking about sometimes posture, expression, silence, the metaverbal, the paraverbal, the nonverbal, all the world that makes our communication, and that makes the 75% of the communication much more important than what we say, is the way we say something, is the manner we say something. And I can anticipate that kindness is the most important thing in Sudan, because Sudan is a kind place, because people of Sudan are kind people, and so having the typical rough way of imposing something because it is right, or because my culture say, but even because my structure, linguistic structure, allows me to speak in some way, probably is a detail that should be, you know, just have a sort of fine-tuning, because maybe you don't go straight to the point. Events, the last slides of Javed, social events, communication went. We are talking about sociolinguistic, the context of the communication, where the communication takes place. And this is more important than sometimes of the communications. On one end, for example, it's to be at lunch having spaghetti with somebody, you know, just in front of you, or having a full, in the case of Sudan, or having tamias with chatta, with for Sudanese, you know, just in a nice restaurant, popular restaurant. Another thing is being on a part of the desk and having another part of the desk, and in some way giving the idea of giving some instruction to the other and say, you know, you are wrong in this, this, and this, instead of this kind of dialogue and approaching of, you know, human beings that you have in convivial and social part. And obviously, communicative skills. I know that somebody, you know, just may have this kind of shortcomings, you know. We, in our career, you know, just I can countless, you know, just of colleagues that probably they are not the best communicator in life. But public speaking, you know, just is not something just for the stories, or just not just something that Americans like very much, you know, just to make university and faculties in university. It's very, very important because, again, the way you speak, the way you create empathy with your interlocutor, the way you are an active or responsive listener, the way you observe a place like this, the disposal of the people, the way they move, the more you understand of a country and the more effective is the benefit that you can give by means of the activity of the program. Next one. Some examples. And, you know, I hope to be corrected if my Sudanese friends, you know, just I'm saying something wrong. Power. We're talking about a country that is a federal state. So there is a central power, but there is also a power in the periphery. And sometimes it's a power of the periphery of the periphery. One thing is talking to Khartoum people. Another one, going to Kassala, is to Kassala. Another one is 2 hours drive to Amashgoreb. That is a place where there is a fantastic Quranic school over there, where, you know, just they see Kassala once a year, probably, and they don't even go there. But even there, we have, you know, just a major, we have, you know, just... The important thing is to find out and to point out the real decision makers. Because if you start looking at and you talk to different people, sometimes you can take, you know, a path that probably is not the one that, you know, give you the solution. Hierarchy is a typical, I would say, consequence of power, and so respecting hierarchy, for example, in the country of Sudan, it's very, very important, from A to Z. I can imagine, for example, a comparison with Scandinavian countries, where it is difficult, it's not visible power, it's not something that you can see very, very easily, and so sometimes, you know, just I remember I organized the G8 in 2009, and I had a group of Sweden people who were guests for a certain time, and I really, in a group of people, I couldn't know about who was the prime minister, who was the chief of cabinet, who was this, this, and this. Information. Sudan is a process in a big, important moment, especially now, of consolidating and strengthening a democratic process. Obviously, if I go there and I start not informing authorities of what I do, what I have in mind, my plans, and with continual exchange of information before, during, after, I'm missing a point in a country like Sudan. In other country, for example, you know, just I come from Naples, you know, just probably in the southern part of Italy. If you started, you have an NGO working there and having activities, maybe, you know, just you can really disappear for months, and then some clerk will come to you and to say, okay, can you make me a resume of what are you doing? This is not the dynamic that we are observing in the country, and information is very, very, very important. Time and timing, you know, just I don't have to, it's, for me, it's, I think it's enough one word, inshallah. Inshallah, it's one word. Time is a value that in the majority, I think, all Islamic country is divine. It's something that appertains to God, if God wants. So, if I go and say, in 1 week you have to free this, and or you have to give me the permission of this, I'm making a terrible mistake. Normal. Because you cannot dispose what is from God. And I'm talking, I'm not only talking about macro system like having more time for accomplish the Ottawa agreement, but also in this you can see a wise way of acting to Sudan, but also in the implementation of very, very simple activities on the spot. And if you have your timetable that is, you know, just your holy scripture and you don't want to go out because of timing, this can be a problem for the country that allows, you know, just and it's a question also to get used to this and to understand. Just a funny thing, I was consul, general consul in Greece, and I had every time appointment outside of my office at 12. It's 12, I don't remember anymore how they say in Greek, but their concept of 12, it's a portion of hours that goes to 12 to 4. So at 12, mine 5 to 12, I was there hungry also, you know, just because I wanted to have lunch, and then some people show up, you know, at 2 o'clock, or 3 o'clock, and I say, wow. At the very beginning, I was very, very angry about that, and I called to my secretary, I say, call to the other secretary, I felt offended, you know, just, why you are disrespecting me, or something like that. Oh yes, in Greece it's mesimeri, the middle of the day, mesimeri. And so, you know, just I understood that, you know, just I was completely wrong, because I'm considering 12, just like my way of considering 12, 1, 2, and feel sharp. It wasn't like that. And then I found a nice solution, because in a certain moment, all this kind of appointment and meetings, 12, okay, in my office. So if you come at 2 o'clock, between 12 and 2, I have answered, I don't know, thousands of email, and I've done a lot of job and something like that. So I can have my appointment, I can have my rendezvous, and then I can have also, you know, just the meeting with the person that is supposed to be late, but in his culture or in her culture, is not late. And then the donor's perspective. I have my colleague of Japan. Japan is very attentive, for example, in Sudan, to a sort of advertisement, the role of Japan, also because it's the main donor. If you try to include, for example, Japan, and I see, I shared it with Javed, into a sort of group advertisement or group only journey, a group only event, probably I'm missing one point, because I remember the Japanese ambassador is say, yes, that's okay, but first of all, I would like my visit. I would like to go there. I would like my speech. I would like to be the protagonist in this case of my, because I'm giving, and this is different from donors. Me too, I'm very, very careful with press and media, and I have to thank Sudanese and especially Javed, because I have to say that every little movement as a donor has been underlined on the media, press communique. Not all donors are the same. So also, you know, just taking care and observing what donors want back from, it's very, very important. Just another example. We are meeting a lot of Arab countries. Their system or delivering information is not like mine. For example, if UNMAS comes to me as ambassador and they say, I would like you to fund my program, I say, okay, I have to talk to Rome, to my capital. In that case, it was incredible, because the majority of time they said, I have to talk with the mission in New York, representative mission in New York. It has much more power than that. So knowing that, that means that we have to meet somebody in New York, probably, and we have to meet also here in Geneva in terms of creating a triangle in which information can pass through, and then we can get maybe also funding from non-traditional donors, which is one of our most important tasks. Kindness, I just hinted before just a little bit. This is the most beautiful part of this country, I have to say. And in Naples, they say when you go and you cry, and when you go away, you cry again. Probably they say the same also in Sudan. You know, when you come and you see, you say, wow, this is Sudan, it will be a tough life. But then when you go away, you know, just you cry again because you don't want to leave. So probably, you know, just one of the, in my personal opinion, you know, just kindness, that is a value, but it's also a metaverbal way of speaking. It's very, very important. Not talking in kindness, not talking in inclusiveness, not talking in a gentle assertiveness risks to create wall and to build, you know, just a sort of lack of communication with our interlocutor. That is exactly what we don't want, because intercultural communication is deliver effective and assertive and winning messages. If we don't do that, the program doesn't advance. Next, informality. The way of finding solutions to problems that in the corridors of institution, of the ministers, in formal way, can be solved at a nice fatur, that is a sort of our brunch, that is around 10 o'clock, 10:30, that's very, very far from our breakfast, very, very far from our lunch for people like me that have breakfast, you know, just at 7 o'clock, and then I have my lunch at 1, at 2. The fatur is 10, 10:30. In front of very, very nice fatur, you can talk, and the informality, you can feel that the Sudanese open up, you know, and it starts, you know, just having, building this kind of trust. Having a different behavior, I am the one that gives you money or the cooperation, so you have to think about that. Probably we're missing the point if we do something like that. So I love fatur. I took 20 kilos in the first 2 years. Then I had to put myself in diet. And so now I have fatur, but I eat, you know, just less than what I have to eat. But I go again on fatur because I like very much to share it with them. And the communicational happenings, exactly like the visit on the field. Visit on the field, it's something that it's really, it's a positive, fantastic trick that should be used. Going there, see the areas, seeing the people working, having this kind of equipment on, and you know, just controlling the situation is very, very different from, you know, looking at around from our desk and considering the situation that is not, is very, very far from what really happens. And Javed yesterday showed a fantastic slide of a corridor that was freed in Gedaref, I think, in Kassala.
Yes, in Kassala.
Yes, in Kassala, with a man with his monkey, with his donkey, I'm sorry, with his donkey. With a camel, with a camel, with a lamb, like that. And all the fantastic signals of UNMAS that say, you know, just outside you still will find mines, but not here, you know, just. And so just went on and wherever. And this was the most important thing. Last, I'm sorry if I'm too long, you know, and you will pardon me. Inclusive observation. Anthropologists taught us, I think, 50 years ago that observation is not watching around, but in order to catch all these aspects, the important thing is to understand what it is hidden, what you don't see. I think Chinese, they say that 2 years they can see and they can watch 10 times more than, you know, just 20 eyes. Because you can understand, you can sense the situation, and you can have the perception of what's happening in a country only with the inclusive observation of all aspects, people, family, timing, in everywhere, just like having in the pocket a sort of, you know, notebook and with a little pen and, you know, just doing down something like that. Oh, thank you. Responsive listening. Responsive listening is not you talk and I stay in silence. Staying in silence, I don't know, probably the majority of you is having an attitude because I'm thinking about the next question that I have to deliver, or maybe I'm thinking about something else. Responsive listening is concentration on the people. Concentrating on the people. This is very, very, very difficult. Yesterday I was talking with a friend. Have you ever happened that you introduce yourself to somebody and you say, good morning, yes, my name is Fabrizio. And the other one say, okay, I'm Carolina. And then 5 minutes afterwards, you know, you forgot completely the name. Because your part of the brain is so concentrating in delivering a message, but not including the message. And this is incredible, interesting in intercultural communication. The more the diversity, the more the concentration that you have to put with people. And I'm not talking only about jokes. For example, the way of Sudanese, they say, wait a moment. That in Naples, you know, just has another meaning, that what the hell are you doing? So the first time that I saw it, you know, just on the street, people like this, and I say, why are you offending me, you know, just with something like that. Instead, it was completely, you know, just a way of saying, please wait, because I'm stepping by with my car, otherwise we clash. So I don't have the right, you know, just to be angry anymore now. But this was also this kind of inclusive observation. Empathy, to try to feel what they feel. A part of the story, a part of the geopolitical situation, a part of the news, a part of everything. We're doing another job here. And I think that empathy with a country, with the people, with the poor people, with the people in the need, is the most important part. And the team building, especially in the periphery. This tribal dimension that we see, for example, in places very remote from the capitals, where the chief of the tribe is very, very important, is to be included. And also this kind of family connections, you know, just a friend of a friend, a cousin of a relative, of a wife, of this and this and this, is something that for some cultures may seem very, very difficult to understand. Father, mother, son, daughter. Instead, this kind of connection, this net, it's fundamental in places like Sudan, where in any case somebody will be relative of somebody else. And so you will find a solution, you know, just asking around. As a chair of the Italy MASC, I was very, very happy of this invitation. And I'm sorry if I was a little, you know, just I overcome the time at my disposal. Obviously, we are at your disposal for any question or even for deepening the subject, you know, just if you want by emails, for example, with something writing or, you know, books or something like that. But let me really deliver to you this message of happiness to be with you and to give a little contribution to this fantastic organization and this country that is striving so much to free their land from all these horrible things that happened in the past. So let's go to the future. Thank you.
Inshallah. So I think we will open for question and answer before, and then at the end, we will have a closing remarks from His Excellency, the State Minister of Defense. So if you have any question, comment, observation, feel free.
I'm Jeff McMurdo. I'm the program manager for UNMAS in Darfur. I'd like to thank the panel for bringing this topic to us. It's very relevant to Mine Action. It's a topic that doesn't always get attention, often overlooked, and it's somewhat philosophical, which is a bit rare in Mine Action with the things we normally talk about. So in that sense, it was very refreshing. But also the last 3 days, we've seen on the big screen in the plenary the motto for 2017, which is needs-driven and people-centered. So in many ways, this side event is very appropriate for mine action in 2017, because if it is about people and the relationships, I think it's not just at the community level, but it's also, we need to give attention to this level in the capitals where decisions are made and priorities are set. And it's so important for these three entities to work closely together as a team. So I'm really, my expectations were exceeded today. Thank you very much for the presentation. In Darfur, it's the dynamics are very similar in many ways, except the donor there is UNAMID, the UN mission. But much of this applies because even within the UN, we have our own cultures. And the culture of peacekeeping and the culture of UN agencies, it does have its differences. So I've learned things that are applicable for Darfur as well. One question, one of the realities of international life is staff rotation. And from my perspective in the region and the meetings that we've had in Khartoum, I've seen the work that the three of you have done and the relationship that's been built up. I'm just wondering what we need to consider when we look, as inevitably happens, that people move on, and then there are new people coming in that need to carry on and sustain the relationships, but also the common goals that have been set and carry that forward. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Marion, and I work for both the Gender and Mine Action Program and the Geneva Center for Demining. And I'm also an anthropologist by trade, so I really, really enjoyed this panel. Thank you. It was great. And I think you showed us very, very well the importance of understanding each other's cultures in mine action management. At the same time, I couldn't help but notice that all the speakers today on this panel are all men. And so this made me wonder maybe if you could tell us how you tried to, in this intercultural model, sort of ensure that there is diversity and gender balance to identify and understand and reach and include women and female beneficiaries. Thank you.
Yes, hello, I'm head of communications at the GICHD, and so this is a topic that interests me very much, and I realize how much it's underestimated, its importance, and also difficult to transmit its importance. What would interest me is to understand how communication as a two-way stream works from the other end. We have been hearing a lot about how an international organization or a mission works towards the understanding of the host culture. Now, what importance does the local, for instance, the National Mine Action Center, give to create, let's say, some understanding towards the needs and also specificities and maybe particularities of the international community coming with the intent to help them and also towards maybe international staff? So is there also an intent and a way the local, the national authorities try to, or see the need maybe, to also create some understanding in the other sense? That would interest me. Thank you.
Well, thank you. About staff rotation, it's an issue. It's a problem, I would say. I have been living in Sudan since 2 years. I have to say that I've spent 7 years in Italy. Maybe it's even too much, you know, just between a period abroad and coming back, also because I started teaching again at university. But I have to say that Italy, in my case, for example, I can speak on our case, are putting more and more attention about these issues. And so probably even young diplomats, that they will take, the place of my deputy and other ambassadors, they will come. Probably they will have more attitudes towards all we said before than probably the older generation about that. But in any case, this is, I would say, an issue, and it's not myself that should suggest that also organizations like yours make the, I wouldn't say only intercultural, soft skills in communications and intercultural communication has a broader workshop in a timetable in some places where you can put everybody from different areas in order to create this, I would say, continual transpassing of information, but not only information, of knowledge, of competence in the attitude on the spot. So I would be the happiest, you know, just man in the world if I can see something, you know, just being, I would say, a habit in an international organization. I don't know if I cannot speak, I think, for Sudanese people about the gender question. So, but I think that I will leave the floor to our friend. But in any case, it's please.
Okay. Good afternoon. His Excellency, the State Minister of Defense and the Director of the National Mine Action Center, they ensure that women play a fundamental role within the Mine Action Program in Sudan, and they have a considerable number of staff within the National Mine Action Centers and in the NGOs which work for Mine Action, and moreover in the mine risk education teams which provide risk education to different communities. So gender is well considered. It might be only they didn't come to this session. Okay, and next month there are two staff from the National Mine Action, female staff from the National Mine Action Center. They are going to come here to Geneva to attend the training within Geneva Center, GICHD, and the director is insisting and adding they are coming alone.
Thank you, Shaza. And to add on, like one among the NGOs in Sudan, FPDO, they have exceeded 50% in the staff, female staff. I think they're around 60%. For you, it's 90%. So, yes. So that's that. But this setup is completely kind of like focused on who actually could be in this panel. So, yeah, I think it has been made very clear that the case of gender has been quite widely considered in the Mine Action Program of Sudan.
Intercultural communication, it's the respect of some values. It's very, very difficult to export a value the way you see and to put it in a country and having, you know, just expectation. So, for, you know, just the most disagreeable you can have, you know, just inside, it's a question of time. It's step by step process that it cannot be, you know, just transpassed. In this moment, for example, in Italy, we have the opposite. I would say, you know, just the gender question has taken completely. Probably it's a good thing. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs, so there are some decisions that they are taken with the. A Grundnorm that is coming from outside that sometimes, only sometimes, put in a shadow quality, competence, and merit because of the respecting of what we signed by law, which is good, I can understand. But a right balance between the two things, I think it is possible to find, and this is step by step, country by country. In the end, about the question of our friend. I have been living 2 years in Sudan and I can testify myself some important changes in the terms that at the very beginning, I make an example, migration. At the very beginning when I spoke to institutions in Sudan about migration, I said, okay, what about migration here, illegal migration? Oh, we are just a country where people step by and they go, so they are not Sudanese. After 2 years, now we are focused with the institutions to understand why there is quite important number of Sudanese that goes from Sudan, and they look for a better future in their mind. So this has been a changing. I still also talking about radicalism, for example. At the very beginning, you say, no, we don't have any problem about that. Now I have regular meeting with the counter-terrorism, and they say, well, we don't have problem in terms of creating terrorists, but we are at risk because our kilometers of borders, you know, just from Eritrea, from Ethiopia, from the Central Africa, from the Boko Haram issue can create problems. So there is a changing, there is a self-consciousness that needs time. Even this is intercultural communication. And as far as UNMAS and all the program are concerned, I have to say that also I'm seeing this kind of step-by-step approach towards the future with the creation of institution, with having, you know, just the same person to whom to talk.
Because we have different people of concern. We have people who are refugees, IDPs, and sometimes returnees. So one size will not fit all. When we are developing, for example, messages for my risk education, when we are developing programs for survivors and landmine victims. So it's very important to consider the communities and the need of the communities, not only to apply the principle, the humanitarian principle of accountability for affected population, but rather also to ensure that the culture is well respected. And as a success story, I think for this year, the My Risk Education standard operation procedures for the community-based risk education in Darfur have been used in a broader way by the coordination, by the cluster, the protection cluster in Sudan as a guide for the community-based program in Sudan. So I think My Inaction is a pioneer, and they initiated in advance, and they consider also to develop different ways and different methodologies. And I really have been touched by your words when you talk about social linguistics. And I can assure you that in Sudan we have a lot of successful stories. We develop peer-to-peer support, child-to-child, women-to-women committees. And I do remember that the first time in my life that I wear Tobit was when I go to Himashkoreb, because I cannot enter with any other dress. So respecting culture is out, and it's out of question. And I think in Sudan we can develop a book or a booklet on success story in intercommunication and intercultural aspects. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shaza. Just something that came out, you know, in my mind when she was talking about that. When you arrive in Sudan at the airport, you see a big, big, you know, just flyer that say, the land of diversity. And this is probably, you know, just the most important logo that you can have. You can interpret diversity on a black part or on a white part. The black part is intertribal fights, Arab against Africans, Islam against Christians, shepherds against nomads, Eritreans against Sudanese, on one end. On the other end, what I think, diversity is a richness. It's a complete richness, because this kind of exchanging is a sort of changing in yourself and for the other. And one of the most important commission of the National Dialogue in Sudan was on the identity of Sudanese people. I always say that once Sudan understand that the identity of Sudan is not Arabic, is not African, is not Christian, is not Islamic, is not shepherd, is not agriculture, but is Sudan, this will be the moment in which the country will be completely launched in the future. Our role is to intercept the moment, to catch, to seize the moment when this will happen, or at least even helping discovering their own identity in this, because this is the beauty of the country.
Thank you very much. So now, with the lines which His Excellency said, continuity to mutual, dynamic, and evolutional relationship. So with this, we see how this further evolves in Sudan, and we have seen a good result as we speak of that. understanding and using the concept of intercultural communication. So the story of Sudan is today is kind of like this purpose of this was this event was to be told to the rest of the people and could be kind of like further communicated through who attended today to your partners, to your people that you know, and probably if this is an area of interest or emerging area or an area that we didn't give a focus in the past, we can further work on it and then we can try to make a good use of it, and so the other countries could also benefit of this. With saying that, I would request His Excellency the State Minister of Defense to say a few words and then closing remarks. Thank you.
Thank you very much for all of you. And excuse me to speak in my mother tongue in Arabic, and Shaza will translate what I will say. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala Rasulullah. السيد المندوب الدائم لجامعة السودان بجنيف، السيد سفير دولة إيطاليا بالسودان، السادة مديري برامج مكافحة الألغام الوطنيين، السادة مستشارو وخبراء الأمم المتحدة والمنظمات الدولية العاملة في مجال إزالة الألغام، السيد مدير مكتب الأمم المتحدة للألغام بالسودان مستر جابد، السيدات والسادة الحضور الكريم، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
His Excellency, Permanent Representative of Sudan to the UN, His Excellency, Ambassador of Italy in Sudan, National Directors for National Mine Action Centers, Technical Advisor from the UN, Representative from the United Nations, and International Organization Working for Mine Action, Director of UNMAS in Sudan, Mr. Javid, Distinguished Delegates, Ladies and Gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum.
نسبة لضيق الزمن أنا ما أستطيع، لكن أنا بشكر حضوركم لهذا المنتدى، وحضورنا كذلك بمثل إثبات لتفاعلنا مع الأمم المتحدة مع المنظمات الدولية في برنامج مكافحة الألغام.
Due to the short time, I will be very short. I will take this opportunity to thank you all for coming here and attending this forum today. And I assure you, through our participation to this forum and to these important meetings, Sudan government is completely have the full obligation to the Ottawa Treaty and to the Mine Action Program.
نحن في السودان كحكومة ملتزمين باتفاقية أوتاوا. وكذلك نرحب بكل الجهود سواء كان من الأمم المتحدة المنظمات الدولية وكل ما يمكن يساعد في برنامج إزالة الألغام في السودان.
Government of Sudan is completely is under obligation for Ottawa Treaty and completely committed to all articles of Ottawa Treaty or Mine Ban Treaty. And Sudan government is in support of all UN agencies and NGOs who are working and planning to work for mine action in Sudan.
أنا مرة أخرى بشكر بعثة الأمم المتحدة وكل العاملين في مجال الألغام وسفير دولة إيطاليا وسفير وحكومة اليابان على الجهد اللي قدموه وبنتطلع إلى المزيد من الدعم ومرحبا بكم في السودان والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Once again, I thank all donors, UN agencies, UNMAS, Ambassador of Italy, Italian government, and the government of Japan. And I will thank you once again, and you are all welcome to support Sudan. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you very much for attendance today, and looking forward to further working with you on this particular important forum. Thank you.